In this video, we learn about pressure in solids and liquids. We have already seen in the previous video that a force is a push or pull upon an object, resulting from the object's interaction with another object. The definition in the book for pressure is produced when force acts on an object. Even though there are non-contact forces, mostly pressure is exerted when two objects touch each other. And now we will also explore that the effect of force also depends on the area of contact between the two objects. Pressure exerted on solids. Here, I push my thumb hard into the piece of wood. I've kept it on the weighing scale to show the effective weight that I'm applying. But my thumb doesn't go into the wood. But in this case, even if I put a slight amount of force on the thumb pin, it goes into the wood. So you can see that the force of the thumb on the thumb pin makes it go into the wood because the pin has a thin tip and therefore the force per unit area or pressure on the wood is very large. Let's do an interesting experiment to see this once more. On one pivoted arm, we put one pin and put it over a PVC board and start putting weight on it. We can see that by the time we had put 5 kgs, it pierced the PVC board all the way. Now let's put 5 pins and do the same experiment. 5 pins will increase the surface area by 5 times. So effectively the weight required on the pin should be 5 times. Let's see. We also needed to change to a heavier weight and then also had to push it down by hand. The weight required was almost 25 kgs. So for now it's close enough because the tips of the pins are also not perfect. We used a PVC board and not wood, because different parts of even the same block of wood will have different densities and that could affect the outcome of the experiment. The PVC board is a homogeneous material and it's same everywhere. Weight is also a force acting downwards. So in this experiment, we showed that the force increased because of the increase of weight. Pressure is the force applied perpendicular to the surface of the object per unit area. Formula for pressure is force upon area on which it acts. The SI unit of force is Newton. The SI unit of area is square meter. Therefore, the SI unit of measuring pressure is Newton per square meter, and this is also called Pascal. 1 Pascal is 1 Newton per square meter. So as an example, if the force is 100 Newton and the area is 2 square meter, then the pressure would be 100 divided by 2, that is 50 Pascals. And similar to grams and kilograms, if the pressure is 1000 Pascals, then it can also be called 1 kilopascal. So now we know that pressure depends on two things, amount of force being applied and the amount of area on which the force is being applied. Let's take another look at pressure using 3 types of soled shoes with 3 people of the same weight so that the downward force remains the same. One is wearing black shoes with small flat heels, another person is wearing high heel lady shoe, and the third is wearing flat soled sneakers. Now they'll take a walk on the sand and see what happens. Here are 3 imprints together to see how the pressure is least in the flat shoe and the most in the high heel shoe. It means that the same amount of force can be used to produce different pressure by changing the area of interaction. So when the middle guy dusted the sand on the other two, he got stamped by both the heels. Which one do you think hurt him more? Here is a person who is first lying on the soft sand, and then he sits up on it, and then he stands. In all 3 situations, his weight, and therefore the downward force remains the same, but the area of contact keeps decreasing. Now he sidesteps to make a fresh imprint. But this time he also increases the force by holding 20 kg weights, and you can see his feet sink deeper. Now you can see that when the surface area was most, the pressure on the sand was the least. Then it increased when he sat up, and then it increased when he stood. And then it increased even more when he added the downward force by holding some weights. So now let's see some examples of how in daily life we make changes in the contact area to increase or decrease the pressure while we do different things. The school bags have wide straps. See, when the straps are wide and padded, the surface area increases a lot and the effective pressure on the skin is very little. But now when he supports the same bag with thinner straps, it is extremely painful because the effective pressure on the skin now is much more. You must be seeing that in the kitchen there is always a sharp knife which you are not supposed to handle. Now why is the knife kept so sharp if it's dangerous? That's because the sharp knife cuts through the vegetable and other food items much easier because of its lesser surface area that comes in contact with the vegetable. A simple way to see it is to cut with the sharp side of the knife and then try the same with the other side, which is blunt. Some knives have a serrated edge so that there's even lesser surface of contact with the vegetables to cut the softer ones better. The tip of a needle, tip of a pin, tip of an arrow, all are sharpened to a point because that's the minimum surface area one can make on an object, and that's to reduce the surface area to make the piercing easier. Similar to the fact that downward pressure is less when you're lying down, as you saw in this case, when one is sinking in quicksand, the advice is to fall flat to increase the surface area and therefore reduce the downward pressure generated by your own weight in the quicksand. If you notice, all SUVs that do off-roading on sand also have thick tires to increase the surface area and therefore decrease the downward pressure on the sand so that it doesn't get stuck. This is also the reason why balloons don't burst when they are put on a bed of nails, and the same principle by which some people show that they can sleep on a bed of nails. Next time you see someone do that, why don't you challenge them to sleep on just one nail? Pressure exerted by liquids. I'm sure you know what are liquids. Water, oil, fuel, milk, etc. All are liquids, and all liquids exert pressure on the base or the bottom as well as the side walls of the container. Since water is the most common liquid, we'll do all the experiments with water. When we pour water into a container, its weight starts pushing down on the bottom of the container, producing pressure. Pressure exerted by a liquid on the bottom can be calculated by the same formula. Pressure is force upon area. But in this case, the force simply is the weight of the liquid, and the area is the area of the bottom of the container. Now it seems obvious that if more water is added, the depth of the water in the container increases, then the weight will also increase. And that means the pressure on the base will also increase. This leads us to learning that the pressure exerted by a liquid increases if you increase the depth inside the liquid. Now, if the above is true, then it also means that at different depths of the liquid, the pressure will be different because the amount of liquid left above the different levels is also changing. This is generally shown by a simple experiment. This experiment has a bottle with three holes at different heights, and you can see that the pressure at the lowest hole is much higher and the pressure at the top hole is the least. I've managed to make a change in this experiment, which I'll show it as a DIY of the lesson. And this experiment is an innovation that even teachers can use to show in real time how at different levels the pressure changes. So now we know that the pressure of a liquid increases with its depth. And that's why you will also come across sports watches that say 10 meters or 50 meters or 100 meters, which means that it can withstand the pressure up to that depth, but not more. Beyond that, the water may enter the watch. When we did the experiment with the three holes in the walls of the bottle, did you notice that the holes were on the side walls? So that means that liquids do exert pressure on the walls of the container as well. At the surface of the liquid, the pressure on the side walls is almost zero. And as we keep going deeper, the pressure increases, and it is maximum at the bottom. This is also why dams are built thicker at the bottom and thinner at the top, since there's a lot more pressure at the bottom. Here's an experiment with a container with no bottom, where at the bottom we put an elastic membrane from a balloon. As we start putting water in it, we can see that the bottom starts bulging out, and once we put enough water, it has bulged out quite a bit. So now if we increase the water in the tube, then the bulge also increases. This experiment shows two things. Firstly, liquids exert pressure on the bottom of the container. Secondly, pressure exerted by the liquid on the bottom of the container depends on the height of the liquid column above it. If the height increases, the pressure will increase. This is the other experiment. Here the same balloon that's blocking the hole is on the side. Once again, as we start putting the water in it, we can see that the balloon starts bulging out, and once we have put enough water, it has bulged out quite a bit. So now if we increase the water in the tube, the bulge increases. This experiment also shows two similar things. Firstly, that the liquids exert pressure on the walls of the container. Secondly, pressure exerted by the liquid on the walls of the container depend on the height of the liquid column above that point on the wall. If the height increases, the pressure will increase. So now this is an experiment with the container with two holes on the side at the same level. The books show the holes on the two opposite sides because when you're drawing it, it's an easy way to show two holes. But we will do it on the same side and on a flat bottle so that we can easily check the amount of pressure which the two streams are coming out with by seeing how far they fall. We can see that they are equal. This experiment also shows two similar things. Firstly, liquids exert pressure on the walls of the container. Secondly, pressure exerted by liquids on the walls of the container at the same depth is equal. Till now, we have seen that liquids exert pressure on the bottom of the container and on the side walls.
The even more interesting thing is that liquids can exert pressure on all sides, including upwards.
A good example of this is if you've ever seen a leaking water pipe on the roadside. You will mostly see the water spraying out, sometimes like a big fountain. This is because water in most pipes is pumped under pressure, and that puts pressure on the sidewalls of the pipes, no matter if the pipe is horizontal or vertical. Therefore, the pressure is in all directions.
That's all on the lesson on pressure in solids and liquids. Let's do a quick recap before we move on to the DIY that you can do as a school project. We learned that pressure is force upon area. The SI unit of force is Newton. The SI unit of area is square meter. Therefore, the SI unit of pressure is Newton per square meter. This is also called Pascal. 1 Pascal of pressure is 1 Newton per square meter. The pressure depends on force applied. The pressure depends also on the area on which the force is applied. Pressure exerted by liquids. Pressure is force upon area. Force here is weight of the liquid, and the area is the base or the bottom of the container. Pressure of a liquid increases with the depth. Liquids apply pressure on the base of the container. Liquids apply pressure on the side walls of the container. Pressure on the walls of the container at the same depth is equal. Liquids can apply pressure in all directions, including upwards. Here's one last look at the subtopics again before we go to the TIY of the lesson. Now let's move ahead with the TIY project, and after that you can click on the next lesson, and that's on pressure in gases and about atmospheric pressure. So as I mentioned earlier, this is a small innovation which allows you to see the changing pressure at different depths. Let's see how you can make it. Take an aluminium rod 91 centimeters long and mark the center of it. The easiest way to find the center is just balance it on 2 fingers and bring the fingers closer till they touch, and then balance it on 1 finger. That's your almost perfect center point. Mark it. And now we have to bend it around the thicker pipe. Keep the center in the middle of the pipe. Ask someone to hold the fat pipe and then bend the rod around it like I'm doing. You can ask someone to help to do this, or you can even do it with a thinner aluminium clothes hanger. Flatten it out nicely and then cut the longer arm to make it equal. Be very careful when you're using a hacksaw or a saw. Now take the soft rubber pipe. The length could be anything around 91 centimeters long. It is important that the pipe is a soft one, because this other kind of harder pipe will give a lot of problems. I got this soft pipe from a medical store. Next, we need to mark and then make a hole for the pipe at the bottom of the bottle. Don't make the hole too big, otherwise it becomes difficult to seal it later. Using a soldering iron makes it easy to make a hole, but it also spoils the iron itself. So be sure to take permission if it's not yours, and be very careful with the hot iron. Thread the pipe in the bottle as shown. And then seal it around the halfway point using a glue gun. The U-bent rod will go into the bottle like this. And the two ends of the pipes will be attached to the rod in this position. You can use the insulation tape to stick it, but if you have a waterproof tape, then it's even better. And now you can put it into the bottle. The length of the pipe that's inside needs to be sitting lower in the bottle, or it might affect the flow. So for that, you can simply rotate the rod and the pipe will coil up and sit in the bottle. Now stick the outside end of the pipe to the other arm of the bent rod. Here's a close-up of the taping. That's it. Now our experiment apparatus is ready, and let's fill water in it and let's check the flow at different heights. Now as I take it to the top of the water level, you can clearly see that the flow is getting slow till it stops. The moment I start taking it lower into the bottle, it starts getting faster, and the maximum is when I bring it to the bottom. I got another idea. What if we turn the mouth of the pipe downwards for the pipe that's inside the bottle? Let's see if it still works. And it does. So this way you can check the pressure difference at different depths. And you can clearly see that the liquids apply pressure on the walls of the container and in all directions, and also that the pressure is more as you go deeper and it's zero at the surface. Things required for the TIY project. Aluminium rod around 6 mm in diameter, marker or a pen, hacksaw, soft rubber pipe around 91 cm long, plastic bottle, soldering iron, glue gun, insulation tape, water,
scissors, round pipe around 50 mm diameter.
So the next lesson is on pressure in gases and about atmospheric pressure. Do keep watching and hope you're enjoying the science while you learn it.